In the second part of section 1.1, we're going to go a little further in problem-solving strategies, and in particular, we're going to look at a few new problems, and we're going to work through them a little quicker this time than the last time. Let's start by talking about a famous problem solver, George Polya, and he had some problem-solving steps that he's come up with. They aren't, you know, incredibly ingenious or anything novel that any of you wouldn't necessarily identify, but they are really keys to being able to step through a problem logically. So the first thing you want to do is make sure you understand the problem. So what assumptions are being made? What is actually being asked? What are you asking, being asked to solve? Those kind of things. What numbers are you actually using? Two, you want to devise a plan. So you might say to yourself in your mind, and I really do advise you actually do this, say, I'm going to guess and check, or I'm going to try to come up with equations, something like that. That's your plan. Three, carry out the plan, actually do the work, and monitor it on the way. This is really important. Monitor, my guess and check is getting really random, and I already tried this, maybe I should work this way. That's monitoring along the way. And last is look back, and this is check your work, check your solution. Make sure you've answered the question that was actually asked. Let's apply these steps to the first example. Again, you should be opening the PDF of the notes that I wrote that go with this so you can see these as well. I believe this is investigation 1.1b. This is the coin problem. I have 8 coins and they total 50 cents. What are the coins? Stop at this point, think about the question, solve it yourself, come back to the video. Assuming that you've done that, let's talk about different ways. Do I understand the problem? I have 8 total coins, doesn't show any restrictions on what they could be, quarters, nickels, dimes, pennies, whatever. It doesn't say any restrictions like that, so I understand that. My answer needs to be what coins I have, so I'm assuming I need to tell them quarters, dimes, etc. So I think I understand. You know me, or you're going to know me better as we go along. I'm going to probably turn to algebra first, but remember our strategies from the first video. We could draw a picture. Maybe some of you will draw out 8 coins and come up with what you could have. Maybe some of you will guess and check, start with big coins and work down, or start with lower coins and work up. Something like that. Okay, this time I don't have my husband's in my work. We're just going to start from scratch. Let's go ahead and try some guess and check. Let's do something out of the ordinary for me. So how do I make 50 cents? Well, what I might start out with is saying, that's 25 cents and 25 cents. But that's not enough coins. That's only 2 coins. So I'm going to break down one of these. I'm going to leave the quarter over here just for fun right now. Maybe I'll break this down into 2 dimes and 1 nickel. So that's 25 cents, right? So I have 1 coin here. So now I have 1, 2, 3, 4 coins. That's not enough. So we need to go further. Well, let's see. How many more coins do I need? I need 4 more coins. So I'm going to look at this penny or this nickel and turn it into pennies. I could turn this into 5 pennies. So now I have 1, 2, 3, and 8 total coins. So that's one solution. Do I know it's the only solution? I don't know that right now. I'm not even very confident that it is. And it turns out there's another solution. We could also have 6 nickels and 2 dimes. And then I'll rewrite this one. This is 1/4. 2 dimes and 5 pennies. Now, did you need to do it this way in order to solve the problem? Definitely not. Algebraically, what I have done? Well, it's a little harder algebraically this time because I'd have to say I have 8 coins. They could all be, you know, how many quarters do I have, dimes, etc. So I'd have a lot of variables going on, and so maybe guessing and checking is kind of a good way at this point. How is this problem different from the pigs and chickens problem? Well, I would say there's a lot more options because our coins can be a lot more things than just 2. The algebra tools aren't as good And maybe the visualization isn't the same. I don't have an immediate visual. Maybe some, however, on the other hand, this is much more kinesthetic. It's much more hands-on. I can get the students up and moving. I could give them pennies and dimes and quarters and have them try to figure it out instead of just this abstractness of trading and whatnot. They could actually have real coins to work with. And that's much different than the pigs and chickens problem. Example two. We are at a bicycle store and we have bicycles and tricycles. And if there are 32 seats and 72 wheels, how many bicycles and tricycles were there? Well, now we're going back and we're thinking, how does this, what does this have to do with the first couple of problems? Where have I seen something like this before? I see a lot more involvement to the pigs and chickens here because I only have, oops, the two options. So I'm going to go ahead and just demonstrate the algebra again. So I'm going to let B equal the number of bikes and T equal the number of tricycles. And then I know B plus T has to equal 32 because that's the seats. Bicycles have two wheels, tricycles have three. So altogether that makes 72. So how can I solve this? Well, I'm going to go ahead and do it the same way. I'm going to do negative 2 times this guy and add them together. So negative 2b plus 2b cancels that out. Negative 2t plus 3t is t. What do we get here? I get negative 2 times 32. So that's negative 64. So 72 minus 64 gets me 8. So I have 8 tricycles. And then my bicycles must be 32 minus 8. So I have 24 bicycles. So 24 bikes and 8 tricycles. And now I can be fairly certain with algebra that this is indeed the only solution. There wasn't any other option that came out of that. Now you can, again, you could go back to draw a picture. You could go back and do guess and check. All of those things would be reasonable and things we would expect from students. I want you to think about how these problems relate to students as well. If you're working on a unit on money, then the coin problem relates very well to the students at that time. Bicycles and tricycles, they kind of understand bicycles and tricycles. They know bikes have two wheels and tricycles have three wheels. Pigs and chickens might depend, but I think those are fairly relatable to kids. So you want to choose things that are in their normal world so they can relate to the problem. Because you don't want them to struggle on that first step of just comprehending things. So let me show you one that might be a stretch for a younger child, but an older child might be able to comprehend it a little bit better. We have an event where we're selling tickets, and we have 812 tickets being sold for a total of $1,912. Students pay $2 a ticket. And non-students pay $3 a ticket. How many student tickets were sold? Now, I think you can understand at this point, we're going beyond the level of a young student. Like, even a first grader could solve a pigs and chickens problem, but these numbers are way too large for a first grader. And the concept of ticket prices at two different, there's all kinds of numbers running around here, too complicated for a first grader. So we're up a little bit in the level. Again, we could solve this in a lot of different ways. Some of you might start with saying, I have 812 tickets. What if all of them were students? So that would be what, 1624? So obviously I have some non-students, but if all of them were non-students, that's way too much. So split the difference somewhere. Of course, I like algebra, so I might go with an algebra thought, so 3n equals 1912, and solve with that. I'm not going to go through the solution. I think you can come up with the solutions on your own using your own methods. But the solution is, remember what the question asked, how many student tickets were sold? The answer to that question is 524 student tickets were sold. Now I want you to think back to those different ways to solve a problem. Guess and check here might be pretty relevant, but you got to be careful that you don't go crazy because you could take a long time. A picture, Not really reasonable with 812 tickets, I don't think. Algebra, definitely an option, but might not be suitable for your level of students. Okay, here's one that's a nice good stretch. Sally works 40 hours a week, and she makes $6.85 an hour. Okay, maybe this isn't really realistic anymore. I think minimum wage is more than that. But her kids are in childcare each day, and the childcare worker charges $15 per day. That's some sort of flat rate for however many kids she has. If you deduct her childcare expenses, how many dollars per hour does she actually make? Take a second to think about this problem. Assuming that you've done that, there are some assumptions to be made here. Definitely. So I know she works for 40 hours a week, but what is that between 4 days or 5 days or what's going on? Maybe she works four 10-hour days, and that's going to change the hourly rate. So I'm going to assume, and this is my assumption, you can make a different one, that she works 5 days a week. So then her daycare costs are 15 times 5, which equals 30, 60, $75. Then I'm going to say she gets paid 685 times 40 hours, and if I multiply that out, I did on my calculator, I get 274. So 274 minus the daycare costs gets me $199. So 685 isn't much if you've got your kids in daycare. Okay, now how do I remember? What did the question ask? How many dollars per hour does she actually make? So I would go ahead and divide that by 40 hours, and I get $4.97.5. So I'm going to round up to 98 cents per hour, and that's my solution. Now you could have gotten another solution, and that doesn't make you wrong. If you state to me, hey, I assumed she worked 4 days a week, then her hourly rate is going to be better. You can say, I assume that she worked 5 days, but she had grandma taking care of the kids 2 days a week, so she only had daycare for 3 days a week. Fine. Those are all legitimate assumptions to make. I want you to think just for a second, however, about things as a teacher. Do you want your students to be able to assume different things and work on it differently? I like it. It depends on the level of students. You may say, nope, I really want them to work together and I want them to be very clear on the answer. I want one answer to the problem. Then you better state the assumption. 5 days a week, kids are in all 5 days, etc. We're not including any sort of income taxes here, so that's something else. The other thing is, this isn't really realistic for many children at a young age, but it might be realistic for kids, say, in middle school or something. They might understand making money and spending money on daycare at that point, and not including taxes, all those kind of things. So you really have to think about this. Could you come up with a problem similar to this that might be more in tune for younger kids? What's more real life to them? Maybe you could say, have a lemonade stand and you make so much per cup, but you have to pay mom back for your supplies. So how much did you really make? That they might be able to key into better than this work structure. And you're still getting to the same idea that you want them to be thinking about a give and take, cost versus revenue, essentially, even though you're not saying the words. Okay, so that's the end of section 1.1. In the next section, we're going to talk about patterns.